Hello everybody, today I am starting module 12. This is the last module of the course, and here we will try to discuss about the bending theory of the cylindrical shell. So, we have learned about the membrane analysis of surface of revolution, then we have studied this membrane analysis of cylindrical shell. The membrane analysis has several advantages and it can give you quick results and reliable results except for the boundaries. Now, it is seen that near the edges or if the shell is long, then sometimes the bending action may become a governing criteria. So, in that case the bending analysis is to be carried out, and different theories are involved for analyzing the shell using the bending theory. Now, here we will discuss some of the theories including bending moment in the shell, but with certain simplifying assumptions. Okay. So, today our topic of discussion will be simplified bending theory of cylindrical shell beam, shell beam and arch actions, considering beam and arch theories. So, in that case the cylindrical shell is analyzed assuming or idealizing the shell as a beam and incorporating the action of beam and arches. Now, let us see in general what are the forces and moments that are possible in the shell element. Here you are seeing an element of the shell, and if you look at this picture which is giving the forces acting on the element, you can see that this edge whose length is say r into d phi. This is the direction of x. So, this length we have taken d x. So, in this edge the longitudinal force n x, the membrane force per unit length, it is acting here. The vertical shear q x is acting here, and here plus sign is given that it is accompanied by increment caused in this shell from the opposite edges. So, in the opposite edges you are seeing that the membrane forces are n x, that is the direct force you can tell along the x direction, in plane forces, and q x is the vertical shear in this edge per unit length, and n x phi is the membrane shear force. On the opposite edges these forces are accompanied by some increment. So, the increment will be say n x plus del n x by del x into d x. So, I have written as plus. So, n x plus indicates this n x plus some increment. This n x quantity here is increased by some increment. Similarly, in the other edges you can see that the membrane forces are denoted here, and the vertical shear q x and q phi are also given in the edges. Membrane shear force n phi x and n x phi are written here, and these are shown here as different, but actually if the distance from the middle surface, that is z, is very very less compared to the radius of curvature of the shell, then the n x phi equal to n phi x. So, similarly m x phi will be m phi x. Now, come to the moment which we completely neglected in case of membrane analysis. So, if we come for moment analysis, then we can see along the x axis the moment is m x on one edge, on the opposite edge it will be m x plus some increment. So, this increment of course will be d m x by d x into d x. Similarly, on the transverse direction, if I see the moment, then it will be m phi, and on the opposite edges it will be m phi plus, and twisting moment m phi x and m x phi are also shown. Okay. So, these moments that you are seeing here, we completely neglected in the membrane analysis, and the analysis of the shell was simplified in absence of these quantities. But it is seen also that near the edges, suppose a cylindrical shell which is supported at the ends on the traverse, and at the edges the shell is treated as free, or if it is joined with the edge beam, then the shell behaves in a different manner. So, if the shell is free at the edges, or whether it is supported at the edges by the beam or any edge member, then also we have seen that the membrane shear force or other stress resultant is not 0 at the edges, but at the free edge that should be 0. So, this is the drawback of the membrane theory, that the stress conditions are not fully or completely realized near the edges where it joins with the beam, or at the cutouts, or in the vicinity of concentrated load. So, therefore, there is a need of incorporating the bending theory in the shell analysis. Okay. The beam theory or simplified beam theory for cylindrical shell actually takes into account of the beam and arch action that we already used in our strength of material courses, or we are familiar with this beam and arch action in analysis of structure. So, these beam and arch actions are brought into picture in case of simplified beam theory of cylindrical shell. Okay. Now, here two actions have to be taken, one is beam actions and another is arch actions, and due to this approximate nature of the theory, the analysis become very much attractive, that it gives a quick solution, and sometimes it becomes a solution which is on the conservative side and can be used safely in the design practice. But these are also subjected to severe restrictions, because in many cases for all proportions of shell, that means length by radius ratio, this theory may not be satisfied. So, let us see what are the advantages of simplified bending theory of cylindrical shell. The bending theory of cylindrical shell actually avoids the complexity of mathematical solutions. So, if I consider the rigorous analysis for bending moment and twisting moment in the shell, the order of differential equation increased to 8. So, this simplified theory, which takes into account of the beam and arch action of the strength of material approach, that avoids the complexity of the solution of the differential equations, and therefore, it can be used very easily for preliminary design, or even sometimes conservative designs can be obtained with the help of this simplified theory. The theory can handle the shells with non-circular directrices. So, that is also another advantages, because in rigorous bending theory that is developed by various authors, there the shell of particular directrix only has to be considered, otherwise the solution can be very much complicated and this becomes unattractive. That means, nobody will prefer to use this type of solution. So, here the simplified theory can incorporate the non-circular directrices, and non-uniform thickness, that is another advantage of this theory. The thickness can be varied along the along the phi direction, that is meridional direction. So, this variation of thickness can be easily incorporated in this theory, but if you consider a differential equation for the solution of bending moment and displacements, then the non-uniform thickness that will produce the non-uniform flexural rigidity of the shell, that will yield a differential equation, governing differential equation with variable coefficients. So, naturally the solution will be too much complicated for that kind of situation. It is possible to visualize structural behavior of the shell quite easily. Instead of going after this solution of complicated differential equation, this theory, bending theory of the shell, which takes into account of beam and arch action, can help one to visualize the structural behavior of the shell very easily. So, these are some of the advantages of the beam theory of the cylindrical shell. Now, let us see what are the assumptions that are made in the beam theory. The deformation of the cross section of the plane in the plane is negligible. So, cross section of the shell, here it is a curved cross section, and deformation in the cross section of the plane of the shell is neglected. So, that is the first assumption. Then transverse bending moment, transverse shear and twisting moment are ignored in beam theory. So, these are the assumptions. Then strain caused by in plane shearing forces and lateral contractions are neglected. So, three assumptions are mainly taken into account to solve the cylindrical shell problem using the beam action. Okay. Now, let us see what are the justification of the assumption. The first assumption tells that deformation in the plane of the shell is neglected. The first assumption is very difficult to be satisfied in the real practice. This theory fails to predict the deformation in the cross section of the shell. However, the difference of this displacement from edges to the crown actually causes the change of stresses. So, change of stresses can be accounted due to this relative deformation of the shell between crown to valley or edge. Okay. So, this is the drawback of this first assumption. The second assumption, that second assumption that we neglected the transverse bending moment, transverse shear and twisting moment, that are true or is idealized in practice if the shell is long one. So, that this quantities, that is transverse bending moment, then transverse shear and twisting moment are neglected. So, this is very important assumption for beam theory of the cylindrical shell, the long shell. Long shell can only be analyzed using the beam theory. Okay. Regarding the third assumption, that is third assumption says that shear strain caused by this membrane shear is neglected and the axial deformations are neglected. So, that is also made in the flexure theory of beams and frames. So, theoretically we can tell that the assumptions can never be satisfied. So, these assumptions are made only to obtain a quick results within a reasonable accuracy. Okay. Now, range of validity. As the theory says that the beam theory or beam analysis is applicable for long shell. Now, this parameter L by R, that is L is the length of the shell and R is the radius of the curvature of the shell. Now, radius of the curvature may be variable. So, here the radius we take at the radius of the crown. So, the ratio L by R demarcates the boundary between short and long shell. Now, how we can say that shell is long or shell is short? If we take a single cylindrical shell without edge beam, then beam theory is applicable if L by R is greater than or equal to 5. The shell may be with different conditions, that edges may be joined with the edge beam or edge member, shell is an integral part of the edge member, or it may be free at the edges. So, if the shell is free at the edges, or shell may be of single span, single barrel or multiple barrel type. So, in the single barrel type, the theory is applicable if L by R is equal to or greater than 5. Okay. If the shell is having no edge beam, okay. But if we take a multiple barrel shell, then the interior shell that can be analyzed, where the edge beam is also present in a multiple group, then L by R ratio should be equal to or greater than 3. So, these two ratios are very important for application of beam theory. Okay. Now, let us see what the theory says. Now, theory is actually bringing the beam and arch action in the shell. Now, shell is here considered as a beam, long beam. Obviously, L by R is greater than equal to 5 for beam without edge beam, for shell without edge beam, and L by R is greater than or equal to 3 if the shell is provided with the edge beam. Now, here we are seeing a cross section of the shell, and generally cross section of the shell is circular cross section. This shell is provided with a edge beam. Okay. Now, edge beam dimension here is the depth is 2a and the width is 2b. Okay. Now, if we see the cross section, this is the crown, this is the location of the crown, and this is the edge beam, the top of the edge beam, which you can call as a springing. Okay. So, here the depth of the neutral axis of the curved cross section is denoted by y bar from the crown. So, y bar denotes the depth of the neutral axis from the crown. Okay. This is the neutral axis where the stresses are 0. Okay. Now, in the cross section, you can also see that the neutral axis is located by an angle measured from the crown, which is denoted by phi n. Now, if I take a small element of the shell here, then area of this element will be r d phi, and this element, this angle subtended by this elemental arc is d phi. So, the length of this element is r d phi and the thickness of the shell is h. So, naturally the cross section will be r d phi. Okay. Now, this element is located at a angle phi. Okay. So, these are the symbol, and semicentral angle is phi k. So, total angle that subtended by the shell cross section, that is you can see it, it looks like an arch, that is 2 phi k. Okay. So, first we will analyze the beam actions, then we will go to find out the stress resultants with the help of arch action. Okay. Now, in the beam action, the shell is idealized as a beam of curved cross section. Okay. If the shell is having a circular directrix, then the cross section of the shell is the part of a circular arc with certain width. And if other types of directrices are there, say cycloid type of directrix or parabolic type of directrix, or it may be also catenary type of directrix, then the cross section will be different. Okay. The familiar strength of material formula for finding the in plane forces nx and shear stress nx phi are used. So, what is nx? Nx is myy divided by iyy z into h. Now, let us explain what are the meanings of this symbol. The meanings of these symbols are understood from this figure. This is yy axis. So, bending moment about yy axis is your myy. Okay. Then iyy is the moment of inertia of the curved cross section about the neutral axis, that is yy axis. So, that is iyy. Z is the vertical distance of any point on the arch from the neutral axis. So, z is maximum you can see at the crown at the extreme fiber, where the maximum compressive stress is developed under the vertical load. Then other symbol appearing in this equation is h. H is the thickness of the shell. Okay. So, we have explained all these symbols here. Then the membrane shear force, the nx phi, will be determined by familiar expression in the strength of material, that is V q by I b. Okay. V is the vertical shear force at this section and q is the first moment of the area at any level about the neutral axis. So, this is the meaning of the symbol q. Okay. Then h is the thickness of the shell and this b is the width of the shell. Okay. Now, the formula for calculation of flexural stress is nx is the direct force, that is the membrane force we call it, but when we find out the flexural stresses, then we divide it by h. So, it becomes myy by iyy into z. So, flexural stress say sigma x will be myy divided by iyy into z, and multiplication with this stress by h will yield the membrane in plane force, that is nx. Okay. The meaning of the symbols are told you, and also it is written here. The maximum moment we generally take, and it if the shell is simply supported at the traverse, then it behaves like a simply supported beam, and maximum bending moment will occur at the center of the span. And if say the vertical load per meter length on the shell is say w and l is the length of the shell, then maximum bending moment in the shell at the centers of the span will be w l square by 8. Maximum shear force will be at the traverse and this value will be w l by 2. So, V is the maximum shear force. Okay. So, meanings of the symbols are now explained. So, the important thing in the analysis of the shell is the determination of the section properties. Okay. Now, since the cross section of the beam, that is beam I call here because the shell is idealized as a beam of curved cross section. So, cross section of the beam is here curved. So, therefore, neutral axis and the moment of inertia have to be found from the first principle, because no ready made formula is available here. Just like a rectangular section, we take it 1 by 12 b d cube. So, this type of formula is not available here. So, we have to work it from the first principle. So, let us see that y bar is the distance of the neutral axis from the crown. Okay. So, y bar will be given by moment of the area about the horizontal axis at the crown divided by total area of the shell. Okay. So, whatever moment of area you are seeing, then moment of this area we have to take about the crown. So, crown is the datum from which we are measuring the depth of the neutral axis. So, let us take the moment of the section of the shell. Okay. Now here we isolated one is curved cross section and another is your this edge beam. So, two edge beams are there, and this since the arch is symmetrical, we can only take in the formula 1/2 and then we multiply it by 2. So, because of symmetry this advantage we can take. So, now it is calculated like that. So, 2 is a common multiplication factor because it is symmetrical. Then we come to the edge beam. Okay. You can see this 2a is the width of the depth of the edge beam and 2b is the width of the edge beam. So, 2a into 2b and its the edge beam CG is at the center. So, it is a distance a from the top of the edge beam and its distance from the crown will be a plus r minus r cos phi k, where phi k is the semicentral angle. That can be easily verified from this triangle. So, if this is r, this distance is r cos phi k, okay, and this distance is again r. So, r minus r cos phi k will give this distance. So, therefore, you can find this a plus r minus r cos phi k is the distance of the centroid of the edge beam from the crown. Okay. Then we come to the curved cross section. Okay. Take an element of the curved cross section that I have told earlier also. The area of the element is r d phi into h. So, r d phi into h is the area of the element. And its distance, the centroid of the area is at a distance of r minus r cos phi from the crown. So, from the crown the distance of the centroid of this element will be r minus r cos phi. So, here we are writing the first moment of the area of this element of the curved cross section about the crown. And since we are taking only one element here, then for the full arch to give this effect, we have to integrate it from 0 to phi k. So, the expression is integrated with a limit from 0 to phi k, and since it is symmetrical, we have already multiplied the expression by 2. Okay. Now, the result of this integration is shown in the next step, and this quantity is divided by the total area of the cross section. So, total area of the cross section is 2a into 2b is the area of one edge beam plus the area of the curved cross section. So, area of the curved cross section, if h is the uniform thickness of the shell, in that case we have taken an uniform thickness, then h into r phi k, where phi k is the semicentral angle. Of course, we have multiplied it by 2 to get the total area of the shell. Now, this expression can be simplified now. The area of the this edge beam, we have now got it 4ab, and then this is the, you can see this is the distance of this centroid of the edge beam from the crown. And after integration, this is the result r square h phi k minus sin phi k divided by total area of the shell. Now, if edge beams are neglected, that means suppose there is no edge beam on the shell, shell is free at the edges, then we can put a is equal to 0, b is equal to 0, and the expression is simplified as r into phi k minus sin phi k divided by phi k. Okay. Now, we come to the calculation of shear stress. Okay. Shear stress is calculated as tau is equal to v q by I b, where the nx phi is nothing but tau into h. So, this quantity is multiplied by h to give the membrane shear force nx phi. The meanings of the symbol has been already discussed in earlier slide. Only new symbols that q is appearing here is the moment of area of the shell above neutral axis, about the neutral axis. So, that we have to take into account. Okay. Now, calculation of the moment of area Q required for shear stress calculation. So, tau is equal to Vq by Ib. Moment of area of the shell above neutral axis, about neutral axis, if we consider, say here. So, R d phi into h is the area of the element and its distance from the neutral axis is R cos phi minus R cos phi n, where phi n is the location of the neutral axis from the ground, okay, angular location. So, integrating this we get that Q is equal to 2 R square h into sin phi n minus phi n cos phi n. So, this is if the moment of area of the shell above the neutral axis is taken about the neutral axis. So, you remember it very carefully that moment of area is taken about this axis n a, that is the neutral axis, but for any other axis also it can be taken just by change of variable. In that case you have to consider this integration limit as general phi. So, at any angle phi you can change the limit of the integral and then write down the expression. Okay. Now, after doing the beam analysis, the results are obtained as nx and nx phi. Next, we go for arch analysis. The object of the arch analysis is to find m phi, n phi and q phi. Okay. But in a shell which has no edge beam, so shell is free at the edge beam. So, therefore, shell is treated as a determinate system. So, in that case no restraining moment will be produced at the edge beam. However, the crown bending moment will be produced and this is due to a quantity which is known as specific shear. So, in that case you can see the equilibrium of the shell element. If I take a element of the shell of unit width, then equilibrium is maintained by the vertical load and specific shear that is developed at the edges. Now, what is specific shear? Specific shear is defined as the difference of shear forces between two edges of unit length of the shell. So, we have taken a shell and edges are one unit apart. So, the specific shear is defined as Q is equal to W by I b into A y bar. So, this is the moment of the area of the shell above the plane considered about the neutral axis. But you can see that at the neutral axis that B is equal to 2 h. So, we substitute B is equal to 2 h here. So, the expression can be simplified here. Single shell, no restraining forces and moments at the ends. So, it is a statically determinate structure. Okay. The specific shear at any points acts along the direction of the tangent at that point. So, it is clear here this is the specific shear, that is Q, we have denoted it by Q, and W is the vertical load. So, the specific shear at any point acts along the direction of the tangent at that point, and specific shear can be resolved into vertical and horizontal components, that is obvious. And if the edge of the shell is free, some of the vertical components of the specific shear will balance the vertical load on the arch, whereas some of the horizontal components will be zero. Single barrel shell, statically determinate system. Interior shell of a multiple barrel, statically indeterminate system. The arch will behave like a fixed arch, and fixed arch analysis by using Castiglione's theorem or the column analogy method or elastic center method can be used. And single shell, barrel shell, it can be analyzed as a statically determinate system. Okay. Let us illustrate the theory with the help of an example. A single circular cylindrical shell is taken here to illustrate the process or approach. Now, following data are assumed. Radius of the shell is 3, span is the span L along the longitudinal direction is 15 meter. Now, here you can see that L by R ratio is 5. So, we can use the beam simplified beam theory of the shell. Okay. So, that ratio you have to see whether the theory will be valid. Now, semicentral angle for the shell is 60 degrees. So, total angle subtended by the arc is 120 degree. Thickness of the shell we have taken 75 mm and total load on the shell, which includes say self weight and other type of loads, that is finishing or say live load etcetera, is 3 kilonewton per meter square. Let us analyze this shell with the help of simplified beam theory. Okay. Say this is the shell cross section. Thickness is uniform everywhere, it is 75 mm, and first we have to determine this quantity, say y bar, then phi n, that is angular location of the neutral axis, then other quantity is say moment of inertia about the neutral axis, that are also required. Okay. So, let us calculate one by one. So, first see rise of the arch. So, rise of the arch is the vertical distance from the springing to the crown. So, that is determined here, r is equal to 1 minus cos phi k. So, phi k is 60 degree. So, therefore, the rise of the arch is here 1.5 meter. Okay. Weight per meter run of the shell, because the load that is given is kilonewton per meter square. So, per meter run, let us determine. The cross section of the shell is r is the radius of the shell, that is constant r, and 2 phi k is the total angle subtended by the arc. So, therefore, the cross sectional area is r into 2 phi k. So, substituting this phi k as pi by 3 in radian, we get this w equal to 18.85 kilonewton per meter. Okay. So, maximum bending moment will be W L square by 8, 18.85 into 15 square divided by 8, and if we calculate it, we get 530 kilonewton meter. Okay. Next is the determination of neutral axis. We have already derived the formula for finding out the neutral axis of the shell cross section with edge beam. Now, here edge beam is absent. So, therefore, this quantity that 4 a b was there in the formula earlier we have derived, we can put here as 0. So, similarly, in the numerator, this in the absence of edge beam, this quantity is 0. So, we are left with only this quantity r square h phi k minus sin phi k divided by h r phi k. That also you can see r will get cancelled here. So, the numerator only r will be there and h will be also cancelled. So, the expression will be here, this r square h phi k minus sin phi k, and h you can cancel it, and r square can be divided by r. So, in the numerator only r will be there. So, after substituting the numerical value of the quantity, we get now y bar equal to 0.519 meter. So, this is a very important parameter for the analysis, that is the distance of the neutral axis from the crown is now found as 0.51 meter, that is 519 millimeter. Okay. So, since y bar is known, so we can now determine the angular distance of the neutral axis from the crown. So, y bar is again given as r minus r cos phi n. So, using the data that we have already obtained, we can now obtain phi n as cos inverse r minus y bar divided by r, because y bar is now known. So, y bar is 0.519 and r is 3. So, this quantity now is calculated and phi n becomes 34.2 degree. Okay. Moment of inertia is now have to be determined. since there is no edge beam, so this quantity may be neglected. Okay. So, we will get here the moment of inertia of the shell about the neutral axis is now I equal to 2 times, because we are considering only one part. So, we are multiplying it by 2. So, 0 to phi k is the limit of the integration. So, r d phi h, this is the area and this is the distance square of the center of the area about the neutral axis. So, r square into cos phi minus cos phi n whole square. Okay. So, this term is expanded here, and using the trigonometrical formula, cos square phi can be written here 1 plus cos 2 phi divided by 2. And there are 3 terms. So, the term by term integration is carried out and limit is substituted. So, ultimately we get the moment of inertia of the shell cross section about the neutral axis as 2 into r cube into h bracket half phi k plus half sin 2 phi k minus 2 cos phi n into sin phi k plus phi k into cos square phi n. Phi n is the angular location of the neutral axis from the crown, and phi k is the semicentral angle, which is given as 60 degree, and phi n already we have determined, it is 34.2 degree. R is 3 meter and h is 75 millimeter. If you put all the quantities in meter, then the I will be coming out as meter to the power 4. So, in that case h has to be substituted as 0.075 meter. Okay. After putting numerical values, we get I equal to 0.1614 meter to the power 4, or in millimeter we can express as 0.1614 into 10 to the power 12 millimeter to the power 4. So, compressive stress at the crown, that will be the maximum, we can determine it now, 530 into 10 to the power 6, it is the bending moment in Newton millimeter. Previously, we have determined the bending moment in kilo Newton meter, now bending moment is converted into Newton millimeter. So, 530 into 10 to the power 6 is the bending moment in Newton millimeter, and this is the distance of the extreme fiber in the compression, that is at the crown, measured from the neutral axis. So, this was determined as y bar, and its value is 519 divided by moment of inertia, that quantity we have substituted here, and ultimately we get the compressive stress at the crown as 1.704 Newton per mm square. So, now maximum tensile stress will be occurring near the edges, and its value is again found as 530 into 10 to the power 6, this is the bending moment, and this is the moment of inertia 0.1614 into 10 to the power 12 into the distance of the shell point, that is near the edge, measured from the neutral axis. So, it is 1500 minus 519, because 1500 was the rise of the shell. So, this value is coming out as 3.221 Newton per millimeter square. So, value of n x at the crown is 127.8, and value of the n x at the maximum tensile stress near the edge is 241.58 kilo Newton per meter. Okay. Shear stress. So, shear stress will be maximum at the neutral axis, and first let us find what is Q, that is A y bar. A y bar is the moment of area of the shell above neutral axis, about the neutral axis. So, that relationship we have derived earlier. So, this A y bar is nothing but 2 r square h into sin phi n minus phi n cos phi n. After substituting the numerical value of the parameters, say r is equal to 3, h is equal to 0.075, phi n is here substituted in radian. So, 34.2 into pi divided by 180 into cos 34.2 degree. So, after calculating this, we get a y bar about the neutral axis is 0.0923 meter cube or 0.0923 into 10 to the power 9 millimeter cube. Okay. So, maximum shear stress is V a y bar divided by I b, and V is the maximum shear force that occurs at the traverse, and its value is W L by 2. After substituting the value of W as 18.85 and L is 15 divided by 2. So, we get maximum shear force as 141.375 kilonewton, and it is converted here into newton by multiplying with 1000, and then we substituted a y bar as 0.0923 into 10 to the power 9, I is 0.1614 into 10 to the power 12. And at the neutral axis B is 2H, so 2 into 75. So, therefore, after substituting we get the maximum shear stress as 0.5390 Newton per mm square. So, maximum nx phi or nx y whatever you call will be 0.5309 into 75, that is 39.81 Newton per millimeter, or it is 39.81 kilonewton per meter. Okay. Now, we have determined the maximum value, but let us see how the nx and nx phi varies with phi. So, that quantity is determined by putting z at any phi. So, the relation between z and phi is obtained here, z is equal to r cos phi minus r cos phi n, that is very much obvious from the figure. And with the geometry you can find the relation between z and phi. So, z is equal to r cos phi minus cos phi n. Okay. H is the thickness of the shell, and now we can find out the variation of n x with any phi. Okay. Similarly, the variation of n x phi or n x y, that is the membrane shear force, phi is analogous to y direction, tangential direction. So, therefore, the n x phi is nothing but, or n x y is nothing but B a y bar divided by I b into h. B is 2 h. So, substituting the B as 2 h, we get n x phi or n x y equal to B a y bar by 2 y. A y bar at any phi is determined as 2 r square h sin phi minus phi cos phi n. So, here is the phi is a angle measured from the crown, and phi n is the location of the neutral axis from the crown. Okay. These values calculations are done in a tabular form, and it is displayed here. Phi is the degree angle that is measured from the crown, it is written in degrees. That is, the shell is divided into 12 parts. Shell is divided into 12 parts, and each part will be 10 degree, because it is 120 degrees the total angle subtended by the arch, subtended by the circular arc. So, each division will subtend an angle of 10 degree. So, we are considering a point in the middle of the division. So, it is denoted by 5. Next division at the center, the angle will be 15, 5 plus 10. In the next, it will be 15 plus 10, 25, and then 25 plus 10, 35. Like that, we can go here up to 60 degrees. 60 degrees is the maximum. So, phi is written in here in degrees, and then it is converted into radian. So, in radian, it is converted simply by multiplying it with pi by 180. So, you will get this in radians here. And then z is calculated, because z we have found out in terms of phi. So, z is calculated at any phi as this. A y bar is calculated at any phi. So, now n x, that is the in plane forces, direct forces, and it is due to bending action of the beam, it is now calculated. At the phi is near the crown, because the angle is measured from the crown, and you can see the maximum value is obtained at the ground. So, but it changes its nature because the compressive stress is reversed after neutral axis. So, the maximum tension is obtained near the edges. The shear stresses are calculated and you can see this maximum shear will be obtained near the this neutral axis, and neutral axis is located somewhere in the 34.2 degrees. So, here we are getting the maximum value. Okay. These quantities are plotted and you can see the variation of n x with phi, how it varies. First it is compressive and then it is this phi is measured from the crown. So, this region is crown region. So, this is the crown point. So, here the maximum flexural stress is obtained and n x is here is 124.7. Similarly, maximum tensile stress is obtained near the edges and its value is obtained here as this 187.3, okay, as shown here. Similarly, the membrane shear force are plotted with the different phi and its variation is shown like that. Maximum shear, membrane shear is obtained at the crown. Okay. Now, we are bringing the arch analysis to find out this bending moment m phi and q phi n phi, of course, will not be significant here because the shell is not restrained at the edges. So, since there is no restraint at the edges, so we do not consider this arch as a indeterminate system and we analyze it as a determinate arch. So, we divide the arch into 12 equal segments of 10 degree as earlier we have shown you, and each division, the center of each division or is located by a angular distance. So, therefore, we start from 5 degree, 15 degree, 25 degree, 35 degree, like that we will go up to this n divisions. Okay. Load per unit length will we know it is 18.85 kilonewton. So, specific shear is the most important quantity in the analysis of the cylindrical shell using the arch theory. So, arch action is only relevant if we can find the Q s. So, Q s is found out 18.85, that is the W into it is converted into Newton, then I is the moment of inertia about the neutral axis, and then 2 h is the B, that is the width of the shell at the neutral axis, and this is A y bar. A y bar is calculated at any angular distance phi. So, this formula is derived earlier also and it is shown here. So, Q s, the quantity Q s is now found as 1.0511 into sin phi minus 0.827 phi. Okay. So, that means, this Q s that is calculated from this quantity A y is substituted here, and this other quantity I we have already found and h is known. So, these are the quantities here, this represents the moment of inertia and this is the thickness, and this quantity is your A y bar. Of course, this r etcetera are squared up here. So, Q s is now 1.0511 into sin phi minus 0.827 phi. Remember that phi should be here in radian. Okay. So, this vertical load on each segment is W s, because there are 12 segments. So, total load per unit length is 18.85 divided by 12. So, in each segment vertical load is 18.85 divided by 12. So, this is 1.57 kilonewton per meter, and the angle subtended by each segment is 10 degree. So, 10 degree in radian we can now find out 10 into pi divided by 180, h is equal to 75. Q s is the specific shear stress. So, specific shear force T s, capital T s, is now found out Q s into A. So, Q s A is h into r d phi. So, this quantity can be substituted here to calculate the numerical value of T s. So, net vertical force shown here is W s minus T s sin phi. So, that is the vertical component of this T s. Okay. That is obvious from this figure, if this is the T s, okay, the radial, the specific shear force, and its vertical component is T s sin phi, horizontal component is T s cos phi. So, net vertical force will be W s minus T s sin phi, and horizontal force is H equal to T s cos phi. So, moment at the ground will be, if I take the moment of this forces about the crown, T s cos phi and T s sin phi, we can now write it as the net vertical forces W s into minus T s sin phi, that is V. So, if we take the moment of the net vertical force and horizontal force about the crown, then we can get it V r sin phi plus H r 1 minus cos phi, and it is summed up over all the elements. And then moment at phi at any location will be found from the equilibrium of the moments. So, moment at the crown minus summation of the moment V r sin phi plus H r 1 minus cos phi. Okay. So, these calculations are again presented in a table. So, phi is written here. It is 5, 10, 25, like that, it will be 10 with a 10 degree interval, you have to write the angle. So, is radian is this 0.0872, 0.2618, these two columns are already displayed in earlier table, that is here, same two columns are written here also. Then Q s, the specific shear is written here, the T s, the specific shear force is written here, the net vertical force is written in this column, horizontal force is written in this column, and then summation of the moment of the vertical forces in each segment and horizontal forces in each segment have to be calculated. So, these are written for in this column, and then it is summed up. So, the elements of this column is summed up, added, and it is found as 7652.62. Okay. So, this summation minus this will be the moment at this element, then this moment minus this moment, this moment will be this. Like this, we will calculate the moment at all individual elements, and then we can get the maximum moment is at the crown, and theoretically, since the edge is free, the moment is coming at 0 here near the free edges. So, this moment is plotted along the phi, and you can see the variation of this moment from crown to springing. And maximum moment m phi that is obtained at the crown is shown here, and it is varying like that and becoming very low value near 0 near the edges. Okay. So, let us summarize today's lecture. In this lecture, a simplified beam theory for the analysis of cylindrical roof has been discussed, and it has been shown that with certain assumptions, cylindrical shell can be analyzed utilizing beam and shell actions. The main assumptions of this theory is that L by R ratio should be within some limit. So, if the shell is without edge beam, then L by R ratio should be equal to or greater than 5, and if the shell is provided with edge beam, then L by R ratio should be equal to or greater than 3. So, the L by R parameters are very important, which demarcates the boundary between the short shell and long shell, and beam theory is only applicable if the shell is long. Otherwise, this the assumption of beam for the analysis of shell is not valid. The simplified theory, though approximate, we have seen that it can yield quick results, that is membrane forces are obtained as well as the bending moment is also obtained. So, we can see whether the bending moment is underestimated or not, or the reinforcement, especially the reinforcement in a cylindrical RCC shell provided based on this direct tensile force can be checked with the reinforcement that needs for the bending moment generated in the shell. So, generally we provide the higher quantity of the reinforcement. The simplified theory can handle non-uniform thickness of the shell. That statement is very important because we have seen that ultimately we have found the variation of the stresses with a different phi. So, in that process we have divided the shell cross section into different subdivisions. So, even the shell is non-uniform, the each division can be of different thickness and weight of the or the load acting on this division will change because cross sectional area will change. So, it can be easily computed for non-uniform thickness also by discretizing the shell into different subdivisions. So, that is the beauty of this method. In other theory, bending theory, where the simplification is done with a uniform thickness, because the differential equation with variable coefficient becomes very complicated and it is it loses the attraction of the analyst because of so much complexity. So, therefore, simplification is done in the differential equation for uniform thickness shell, but in this theory since it can be discretized into different elements and element by element computation can be done and it is summed up. So, the non-uniform thickness can also be incorporated. And lastly, we have I have shown a numerical example of a single barrel circular cylindrical shell subjected to vertical load, and we have analyzed this using the beam action to find out this nx and nx phi or nx y, and then also using the arch action we have calculated the bending moment at the crown. Thank you very much.